certain that this part of Texas has at least a few people who have never heard good news or who are hungry to hear it in another way. And I think that's what reimagining the church is about. How can we be present with people in a culture that's changed radically, even in the Bible Belt, where people ask deep spiritual questions but don't have communities where they can wrestle with them together with other people who are seeking? I'm going to tell you where I went to church last Sunday. I was in the office for a couple of days and I didn't have any Sunday duties. I got on the subway and went across the East River to Brooklyn. And I got off at this subway stop that was really gritty. It just, you know, you probably don't want to be there at midnight by yourself. And I walked a block down the street to a place that weekend nights, and I think lots of weeknights, is called Radio Bushwick. It's a music venue and a bar. And on Sunday at noon, there's a sign on the sidewalk that says Bushwick Abbey. Church that doesn't suck. It's a part of Brooklyn that is filled with young adults who come to venues like Radio Bushwick in the evening. And a young priest who, when I saw her this time, had blue hair, has helped to start a community there that meets at noon, late enough that people can sleep in. And it's a very conscious decision. And it meets in this venue. They use the stage as altar space and band space, and there were two guitarists, a drummer and a keyboardist, with both a keyboard and a piano. The service, the regular Sunday gathering, started about 2 months ago with, I think she said, four people. Last Sunday there were 25. Aside from me, there was a couple with grayer hair than mine who sat in the back at the bar, and a 10-year-old boy who I think belonged to the priest and her husband, and 22, 23 other young adults. Two-thirds of them were guys, which I rarely see in churches. This community has spread its version of good news in Brooklyn and beyond in a way that is calling people to join. The music was great for that context. It might drive some organ aficionados elsewhere, but it was exceedingly appropriate in that context. They are writing music and lyrics for that context. They are repurposing some old things in new ways. And the liturgy was very recognizably Episcopalian. It was done decently and in good order, but it fit the context. There were some dogs there, too, who came with their owners. You know, in New York, there aren't a lot of parks to take your dogs to, so people get up in the morning and walk their dogs and do it again in the evening. And being able to go to a place where you can bring your dog is a real, real bonus. The coffee hour afterward was set up on the bar, and there were the usual push pots of coffee, but you could buy yourself a beer too if you wanted. That community is mushrooming. It's responding to a need in a context in a way that makes sense. That's an example of reimagining the church. The essentials are there. The heart of Jesus is there. And people who are hungry are finding it. So, how are you reimagining this part of the world, or the pieces and parts in which you dwell and move and work and meet people? Yeah. Why don't you stand and we'll do this in a way other people can hear.
We have a service for the homeless in Thanksgiving Square in downtown Dallas. And it started with maybe six a year ago, and it's now up to 100 people.
Oh.
They bring their dogs.
Uh-huh.
They bring their backpacks, everything that they own.
Yeah.
They have developed a community. At
mm-hmm.
first, when we passed the peace, it was, you know,
mm-hmm.
I'm not going over there. And now they greet one another. There are other people that come down and bring food. Different churches are bringing food every week. It's at 1 o'clock, so it's after
yeah.
the regular church
mm-hmm.
service. And then they have a Eucharist, which is grape juice, because a
mm-hmm.
lot of them are needing
right.
that. And then they have an extended Eucharist meal, which is food.
Right.
Sandwiches sometimes meatloaf, sometimes fried chicken. Whatever a church wants to bring, they bring.
Mm-hmm.
And they are always graciously thanked by all of them. They went to Moore, Oklahoma to help the people of the tornado because they had their homes and they lost them, and they thought they needed help. So like a group of seven of them went up there to help, and then they went back and like 10 of them went back and wanted to help again.
Mm-hmm.
They liked that. They
mm-hmm.
liked helping.
Mm-hmm.
So it is a unique community for people that need a community
mm-hmm.
and are forgotten.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And it sounds to me like the people who are temporarily housed, who helped to get that going, are finding something amazing in their own lives as
yes,
well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Others? Or what gets in the way? What makes it challenging to think about doing something new and different?
Well, we're at St. Albans in Arlington, and we meet
okay.
in a theater.
Aha. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
We don't have a kneeler. We don't have center
mm-hmm.
aisle to process, but it's filled with God's love and the environment
mm-hmm.
that we're in.
Mm-hmm.
We reach out to people in the theatrical community and in the school
right.
around us and in the school system in the, Arlington Independent School District. We find that we find freedom in not having a building.
Yeah.
We find the freedom to reach out
mm-hmm.
beyond the walls of the church.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's going to do us well for a lot of years to come.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you. Who else? Can you pass it down?
At St. Albans, I don't know if Don said this or not because I couldn't hear him, but we've started successful campus ministry too. I don't know a whole lot about
successful,
it, but it's very successful
okay.
campus mm-hmm, with UTA, and have a good start there.
What does it look like?
I don't know. Who's working with the campus ministry?
Somebody behind you?
Sure, Sharla. Oh, she's a clergy that's gone.
Okay. Are any participants in that ministry here? Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Most of them are
sitting up front. Good, good. All right, here.
We actually are all part of the Episcopal Campus Ministry right here. There's not a whole lot of us just yet. We still need to get more of a campus involved, but it's how I found the church. Kaylee Chapman's not here today, but she is a lifelong Episcopalian who convinced me to go to the ECM meetings, and from there I was able to start going to St. Albans and getting involved, and then I was confirmed last July, so yeah. Wow. So the ECM has helped a lot, the Episcopal Campus Ministry. Mm-hmm. Just, it's kind of getting more of the campus involved that we're kind of working on right now.
Fantastic, thank you. Anybody else?
I'd say that, yeah, we've had that actually happen with two different people who have been part of the ECM group, and I think that the biggest number of people that come in are by people directly asking. Like, you know, if you have a table out or signs out, that doesn't bring in a lot of people, but if you have somebody who's a friend and they're living in the dorm and they're like, hey, anybody want to come? We're doing X tonight. That's brought in more people than anything else, I think.
Thank you. Thank you. You're absolutely right. Come on, follow me over here. Isn't that how it works? Thank you.
Something you said the last time you were here, 7 years maybe, six, we were at All Saints. And you have been making me crazy from that day to this. You said, look to the left and look to the right. Those are God's beloved children. It made all the difference. And I've been looking at them since you came. And we've been blessed in so many ways. We had the imaginable privilege of taking in a homeless person.
Wow.
You did that.
God did that. Bless you. Thank you. Yes, I'll come there next.
Leslie and I are from Good Shepherd and Granbury. A lot of you probably know we meet in a Seventh-day Adventist church, and it's been a long 5 years in having to set up an altar and all, but we've been blessed in so many ways, and one of them is that quite a few Seventh-day Adventists will join us at Christmas or an Easter service.
Wow.
And we're the only church, I think, in the diocese or maybe in the world that has a greeter that's a turkey. We have a great big turkey gobbler. And he spreads out his, its fan behind him and meets all of us at the door every Sunday morning. We look forward to seeing him.
That's wonderful. I think other congregations might say that they also have turkeys, but...
I'm Mary Ferguson from St. Luke Stephenville, and we also have an Episcopal campus ministry that I and approximately 20 other people work with. And first of all, it's brought a lot of us very close together. We cook for about 200 students a week. It's part of Tarleton State University's culture to have free student lunches. The kids love it. We've had kids come in and start playing the piano and sing, and they will come in the kitchen and visit with us. There's certain people at St. Luke's that love to go and visit with the kids. It's just become much bigger than anything we ever expected, and it's about 2 years old.
Wow. Thank you. Yeah.
I'm a member of the Episcopal Campus Ministry at Trinity here in Fort Worth. And it's very exciting because I showed up at Trinity the Sunday before we were starting back this ministry that had been long held tradition at Trinity Church, working with TCU and Texas Wesleyan, that had been lost for a period of time because of the split and everything and questions about how to get this started. And it's wonderful because we're small, but we're building our community. And I'm here, I'm the student at Wesleyan, studying religion and in the very early processes of considering discernment for the priesthood. And I would just like to say that I'm very excited about my future in the Episcopal Church and the fact that we are realizing again, we are a missionary society and we are called to proclaim the gospel. And as someone who is hoping to devote his life to this church, I have so much excitement for the future and the mystery of what will the church look like and where will I serve?
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm Lynette Carpenter, and I'm from St. Stephenson-Hurst. And we've also been blessed to be without a building because we have a tremendous church family. But one of the things that I've been doing, thinking about how to reimagine the church, is I've been asking people that are not Episcopalian but are from large churches. And one of the things that that one of the churches did, a friend of mine, he said they brought in a 12-step program for Christians. I mean, that it's already established. And he said that just, people came in droves for that. And he said the reason is people are looking for tools. They're looking for, they've got the Ten Commandments, but they need tools to learn how to live their life. And so that has been a huge pull. And I talked to two people who were big-time Joel Osteen fans, and one is in Houston, and one was here. And they said that the reason that that is so full is because of the good news, that he's very, very positive. And they feel that they leave with, that's right, tools. That they walk off and they feel like, okay, for this week, I'm going to try to not hold resentments, such as that.
Right. Thank you. Thank you for naming that. We have historically used different language about spiritual formation, but that's what it's about. It's teaching people techniques and patterns of life that help us to live a holier life. It's a matter of translating the great legacy we have into language and music and images that make sense in a different culture. Thank you.
I'm Dave Kincannon from St. Luke's in Stephenville. And as a caveat to what Mary Ferguson was saying, there are a bunch of campus ministries at Tarleton, but you got to go in and you got to get prayed with and all this sort of stuff. We have been very careful not to do anything like that. We say, come in and join us, be a part of this, have a meal. And nothing said, no pressure. And we went from having like one or two kids to like consistently over 200, or in the neighborhood of 200 kids per week show up. But what I'd like to speak about is that we have the ECLA, those are the Evangelical Lutherans. We're in communion with those good folks. And we have a service in conjunction with ECLA every week. And this is something where they're a small, they have fewer folks around than we do, it seems, at least in our area. But this is something that everybody might look at, where we can go out to some other denominations where we're in communion and provide services for them, a place for them as well.
Right. Absolutely, and thank you for naming that. We're in full communion with the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, with the Moravian Church. You know any Moravians in your neighborhood? Good. I see a few nodding heads. There aren't many in this part of the country, but there are some. It's the first Protestant church, the oldest Protestant church. and it has a very faithful history where they almost disappeared because they were oppressed so heavily. They have a lot to teach us, particularly about staying in conversation with people who disagree. And they have a remarkable musical tradition. We're also in communion with a couple of other bodies of whom there are not many in the United States part of our church. But we can do things with the Methodists. We can share Eucharist with the Methodist under particular circumstances. We can do mission work with the Presbyterians and the Roman Catholics and the Mormons and the Buddhists and the Jews. Right? Right? When we share values about caring for human beings and creation, we can work with people. And that is, believe me, a way in which all of us grow. I'll come around and get it.
Yes, ma'am. I'm Lou Eichenberger. We're a little confused about who we are. We started out being the Episcopal Church in Parker County. We're basically now back to being just St. Francis. And we're still trying to decide what the right name is because the other group, I lost you.
I'm just coming around. Go ahead.
The other folks that are in the building also call themselves St. Francis, so it's hard to, you know, come to our church. Well, where's your church? Well, it's St. Francis. Well, which one? Mm-hmm. So, we've been through the meeting in a home, then a school, and now we're renting a parish hall from CCC. We've got folks that are doing music efforts at nursing homes and stuff. Mm-hmm. So we're a small group, but we get around. it's an interesting and different way to worship.
Thank you. What gets in the way, or what makes it difficult?
I would just like to say that one of the things I'm really happy to see us reimagining is our relationship with TCU and the Disciples of Christ. I don't know if Bishop Katharine knows just how unusual it is to see all these Episcopalians in this room. I've been here many times, but it's always been for Minister's Week with the Disciples of Christ and so forth. But now, not only do we have our campus ministry going again, but we have a wonderful new program in Episcopal and Anglican Studies at the Bright Divinity School. Mm-hmm. And I know that the Bright Divinity School has wanted to have that for years and years. So happily, now the Episcopal Church is open to that, and we're doing that. And we have a wonderful new person on the faculty, Dr. Ed Wagoner, who was installed just a few months ago. We have other people who've been teaching there. Dr. David Brockman and Fred Barber, who helped to establish the program teaching canon law. And it's just so wonderful to have this. It's wonderful that the chair is named after Bishop Halsey, who has helped even the Women's Caucus. But to hear him get up and give such wonderful sermons at the Bright Divinity School, to have this chair named for him and to have him encouraging that program, it's just a true sign of hope.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I hang out with Sharon Watkins periodically.
Oh, yes.
who's the senior minister of the Disciples of Christ. One in the back. Thank you. Hello.
My name is Sherry Shipp. I attend Trinity Episcopal Church, and I don't have any answers. I only have questions.
Good.
And so my question is, as society's changed, how do we get children to be in church on Sunday? And so children aren't near the church on Sunday. They're at the soccer field, or they're at the football field, or they're somewhere else. So really, I think I'm asking the same question that the folks in New York are about the bar. Mm-hmm. And that is, how do we take church to people who are not already in a church somewhere else and make them Episcopalians? How do we take people who are not in church at all and give them a spiritual background? And I think the way you have to do that is ecumenical partnerships, like you were talking about. But I don't think we're thinking in big enough terms yet.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you for raising that. I don't have an answer. And I would, as you did, respond with some more questions. What is it that children who are unconnected to faith communities, what do they need? What are their parents needing? And it means we have to go there and encounter people with that kind of hunger and ask. It means we have to be present enough to learn, open and vulnerable enough to let them teach us. And that's not historically the way we've tended to do things. School near you, any connections you or somebody in your Episcopal community has with children already, other children, friends of children in your community, talk to the parents, talk to the kids. What are the holes in their lives? Good news responds to a yearning and an emptiness. You can't just add maraschino cherries to a banana split that's already too much. You have to encounter somebody who's looking and ready, may not know exactly what it is they're looking for, but you have to hear that question, that yearning. And then you'll discover the answer together. I will come round. If you've got a big voice, stand up. There were a couple back here, and I'll come up here.
I do, but I'll take the mic. Thank you. Norm Snyder from Good Shepherd in Granbury. We have a friend of our congregation who is a Hasidic Jew rabbi, mm-hmm. PhD linguist. Mm-hmm. And because we are renting space from the Seventh-day Adventist, 2 years ago, he did a Pesach for us that included his Jewish friends, the Episcopalians, and the 7 days.
Wow.
He has now moved away, but we are working with the Roman Catholic Church, where he also has friends, and we are probably going to bring him back to do it again this year.
Fantastic. Thank you for that. You know, there are a couple of Episcopal churches that I know of in the United States who have a rabbi in residence. Now, there was, there was somebody else who had his hand up here. Yes, right, and then we can pass it back. Is that?
If the Episcopal Church wants to survive and thrive in the 21st century, it's got to stop playing church. What's killing the church is people who want to circle the wagons and play church, and everybody's happy and joyous and wonderful, and walking around with smiley, shiny faces, and half of them are dying inside, terrified to actually say what's going on in their lives for fear of being ostracized. The church has got to get out of the church and into the world. If Jesus came back today, he would not be at All Saints or some beautiful church. He'd be down on East Lancaster with the homeless. And the way to reach the kids, the way to reach the people who desperately need help is to meet them where they're at, the same way Jesus did. You go and you meet them where they're at and say, come and see. And then you don't judge them for being different. You love them. I spent my life, I grew up at All Saints, and I left the church after a 3-year diaconal process sponsored by the Fort Worth Diocese, and because I ran into a brick wall at the end of it, I went off for 40 miles, 40 years in the desert with the 1928 prayer book bunch and all that stuff. And I even attended the big concordance they had in Pittsburgh with the African archbishops and everything. And what I saw there was a bunch of people positioning, no love whatsoever. There was a lot of Pharisaical action, and I came to terms with that and realized this is not for me. And I've come back to the church I grew up in because I believe that it now is seeking what I need and what I believe that the world needs. And I'm very grateful to get to be here today.
Thank you. Thank you for that witness.
I just want to say what I'm hearing everybody say, including him, is that what we're here to do is to church the unchurched. Tools, language, to church the unchurched. Sorry, Mark, but Pharisaical, my favorite sentence. You don't have to say the feline creature crashed upon the mule edifice to say the cat sat on the couch.
I missed that. Sorry.
Well, I didn't know what Pharisaical meant either, but church the unchurched, yeah.
That's certainly a piece of it. And in the process, to be transformed ourselves. We don't have it all. We don't have it all. And we never will.
I'd like to comment on Sherry's question about how do we reach the families with young children. Okay. Because we've had some success at St. Albans, and that's St. Albans in the theater, and that's where we're growing. And I would like to suggest that perhaps we need to look at Sunday school that sucks. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot of that. Most of my Sunday school years sucked. And at St. Albans, we found Sunday school that is deep, okay, and deep, steeped in tradition. And so we're using Catechesis of the Good Shepherd. Yep. I know that All Saints uses Godly Play. These are two Sunday school programs that don't suck, but they require intensive training from the teachers. And we have at least 6 or 8 people at St. Albans who have gone through many Saturdays of training to build a powerful curriculum. And it is bringing in families because their children want to be in the atrium on Sunday and learn what it means to be God's child and part of the Episcopal Church.
Right. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Oh, hello, everybody. My name is Claudia Moreno. Me and my family, we just joined the Episcopal Church, this diocese in Fort Worth. We joined St. Christopher Episcopal Church. I'm a Bright Divinity School student. We just moved from Mexico. We come from the Anglican, the name is the
Iglesia Anglicana de Mexico?
Yeah, that's right, but the Diocese of the North of Mexico. And we have, we're such a young family with young children. And you have been very honest about what you say, the children's programs and children not really very involved in our church. And in my house, my kids sometimes tell me that church is boring. And that's a problem I'm facing, and I just want my church to know about it. Because my kids have been growing up in church. They were born in church. And I just would like to pass it on to my church, so as a family, we just can get some sort of an improvement on that, working with our own kids, so they can really get to know the faith, get to know Jesus, get to know what is to love our Lord and our Savior. Thank you.
Muchísimas gracias. Thank you. Thank you so much. I have to turn this over to the president of the House of Deputies, who will carry on better than I.